Hello, everyone, and welcome to another soul-stirring discussion in human biology. In this chapter, chapter 5, we are going to start to talk about the cardiovascular system. So, the cardiovascular system is primarily composed of your heart and the blood vessels and the connective tissue, which flows through those those blood vessels, and that would be the blood. Here in chapter 5, we're going to talk primarily about the heart and the blood vessels themselves and how they do their job, what their job is, and exactly what are some key elements that you should especially know about in the cardiovascular system. So clearly, the heart's job is to pump blood through the blood vessels all throughout the body. And by pumping that blood, it's able to bring nutrients to cells, get rid of waste, and exchange substances through the interstitial fluid. So it's also able to maintain the volume of blood and the pressure that should be in within the blood system, the blood vessels. The lymphatic vessels, that's a completely different chapter. It has more of an immune response, but they work hand to hand with the cardiovascular system. So you will probably routinely see your textbook or hear me talk about lymphatic vessels, lymph nodes, or the lymph because they really do work together. So here we're looking at the cardiovascular system and looking at its relationship with homeostasis. So being able to maintain the volume of blood or the volume of fluids within your body. It works with your kidneys, which help to filter the blood, your liver, and also helps to kind of detoxify things that come in your body. But then it takes those really good things, those good nutrients, go from your digestive system into the blood. Your blood makes its way to the lungs so that the red blood cells, which are a big player in all of this, can pick up oxygen and drop off carbon dioxide, all meant to keep your pH in balance. That's done metabolically through your kidneys and your liver and your digestive system, as well as metabolically through your respiratory system with your lungs. So it keeps your pH in check, the volume of fluids in your body in check, and it also makes sure that you have the appropriate amount of oxygen in your body as well. So all of those things need to be maintained at any point in time. So some of the main functions of the cardiovascular systems are: A, it needs to transport gases and waste and nutrients to where they need to go. So they get two gases that we're primarily concerned with are oxygen and carbon dioxide. Oxygen, we totally need for your cells to gain energy. Carbon dioxide, a waste product that we have that we just need to exhale out into the atmosphere. Any waste products, leftover things from the end of any metabolic process that happens in your body, whether it's protein building or lipid building or breakdowns of carbohydrates, anything that your body doesn't necessarily need needs to be filtered out. Getting all that good stuff you do need, like glucose, amino acids, lipids, and even hormones can be transported through the cardiovascular system. It also provides some protection. Although there are the red blood cells, which are the most numerous in your cardiovascular system, and their job is to carry gases, oxygen, and carbon dioxide, you also have white blood cells that also will elicit an immune response. So that's how they provide the protection to your body. And as we saw on this slide before, there's a regulation of homeostasis for various different body conditions, including pH balance, even electrolyte levels. And when we say electrolyte levels, I want you to think of sodium ions, potassium ions, chloride ions, anything that has a plus or a minus side by it, bicarbonate, hydrochloric acid, to make sure that those electrolyte levels are where they need to be. Too low or too high can be a problem. So as I kind of mentioned before, the cardiovascular system and the lymphatic system, they kind of work hand in hand together. So the way the lymphatic system works is that it will assist the cardiovascular system by collecting excess tissue fluid and then returning those to the blood. And then at the same time, some of that, if the blood pressure is low, the lymphatic system can deposit some fluids or some lymph into the blood vessels in order to increase the volume of the blood, thereby also increasing the pressure. So when fluid from the circulatory system, other name for cardiovascular system, enters lymphatic vessels, we call it lymph at that point. Although the chemical consistency doesn't really change a whole lot, you don't have the erythrocytes or red blood cells formed elements in the lymphatic vessels, but all the other parts of the plasma are pretty much the same. And we'll talk more explicitly about what is in whole blood and what I mean by plasma, in chapter 6. So there are three types of blood vessels, and all the blood vessels in your body can be kind of categorized as one of these three types. You have arteries, which always carry blood away from the heart, A for artery, A for away, and they are going to have for the most part, three layers. The inner layer, called the endothelium. We have the middle layer, which is that smooth muscle we talked about in chapter 13, which is not under your conscious control, and it has those nice rhythmic contractions, so it can constrict the blood vessels or it can dilate the blood vessels. And then you have that outer layer of connective tissue. So when we compare arteries versus veins, some things that we notice are that veins have a much larger lumen or space on the inside than arteries do. Veins also have a more collapsible type wall, if you will, so the wall is a little less rigid, whereas arteries have a very nice rigid wall. Veins also have valves, and the job of those valves is to make sure that the blood only flows in one direction, and it helps to combat gravity when you have blood that's in your lower limbs that needs to get back up to your heart. And veins don't have a heart or a pumping action attached directly to them, so there are certain things that they have to do in order to get the blood back up to the heart. And we'll talk about those when we get in a deeper discussion about veins. So for arteries carries blood away from the heart. There are different classes of arteries. And the first class of arteries that we're going to talk about are the arterioles. So you do have this class of arteries that are called like the muscular arteries, and those are the arteries that directly leave the heart, like your aorta is a great example of that. Arterioles are much smaller arteries, and their middle layer of smooth muscle is kind of what they're mostly made of. So they don't really have a whole lot of connective tissue on the outside, and they don't have really, their endothelium is just one layer really, but the middle layer has mostly these smooth muscle layers, most of the cells, and that allows for it to contract and to, which will restrict the blood flow, or they can dilate, which will increase the blood flow. So when a blood vessel or arteriole reduces the blood flow, there's going to be more pressure that's exerted on those walls because the volume of blood is still the same. It's just that the artery's gotten a little bit tighter, so there's not as much room, so there'll be more pressure or more pushing out of the fluid, the blood, against the walls. So think about it this way. If you have a water bottle and you take that water bottle and you try to put it into like a sandwich bag, so the contents of that water bottle, those 8 ounces or so, or 12 ounces, if you try to put all 12 ounces into a little sandwich bag, you'll notice that sandwich bag is going to get really, 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 really fat. There's a lot more pressure that's exerted on the walls of those sandwich bags, or it gets fatter because you've put that high volume of water in there. So the volume of water didn't change, but you may ask yourself, well, why is it the water bottle is so not so taut, whereas my plastic bag is very taut when I try to put that same volume of water in that plastic bag? Well, what's happening is that the space has been decreased, so the molecules, the water in this case, are going to exert more pressure on the outside of that plastic bag, and that's what causes it to, that's what we mean by an increase in blood pressure. So when the opposite happens, when the blood vessels dilate and increase in diameter, that's going to increase the blood flow, and as a result, it's going to reduce the blood pressure. So if you take that sandwich bag and instead put it in a gallon bag there, that gallon bag that you put the 12 ounces of water in, it's not going to fill the bag up completely. So there'll be less pressure that's exerted on the wall of that bag than what we saw on the wall of the sandwich bag. So arteries leave the heart through the muscular arteries to the arterioles, and then they go down into the exchange vessels, which are called the capillaries. So the capillaries are really microscopic vessels between the smallest of the arteries and the smallest of the veins. So the walls of capillaries only have endothelium, so they don't really have a muscular layer like we saw with those arteries, and they don't have a lot of that connective tissue layer out there. It's really just one layer. The capillary beds are where the gas and nutrients and waste exchange is going to happen between the arteries and the veins. And then you have these sphincters that are around the capillaries that help to control the flow of blood through the capillary bed. Because remember, there aren't any of those layers of smooth muscles in the walls of the capillaries. So in order to regulate that blood flow, we have these sphincters. When those sphincters or precapillary sphincters are closed, blood flows through the atrial venous shunt, or there's another little pathway that it can go through. So here's just a really cool picture of that. So we have our arterioles on this end. There's our artery. And then we have our venules, and we have our vein. And then we have these precapillary sphincters, these little pink jobbies right here. So when they're closed, then the blood has to flow through the atrial venous shunt and goes down to make its way from arteries to capillary beds, where the exchange of gases and nutrients and waste takes place, and then makes its way to the venule. So if arteries carry things away from the heart, capillaries are the exchange vessel, then veins carry blood back to the heart. Now, attached directly to arteries is your heart. And it has a very strong contractions that take place to help propel the blood through these blood vessels. However, by the time the blood gets to the veins, it has reduced in velocity or reduced in speed. So there are certain things that veins have to do in order to effectively bring that blood back up to the heart. So the venules are the small veins that receive the blood from the capillary beds. Veins, as we said before, carry blood towards the heart. The venule and the vein walls have the same three muscle layers, but the composition of those layers, so remember we had the connective tissue layer, we had the smooth muscle, and we had the endothelium. However, the veins have less smooth muscle in that middle layer than arteries do. And that's going to account for arteries being much more rigid and much more firm than veins are. And they kind of need to be much more rigid and much more firm than veins are, simply because they have to withstand all of that pressure that's generated by the heart. So arteries or veins, as I said before, have to carry blood against gravity. As a result, they have valves to keep the blood from flowing backwards and pulling, even though sometimes you can have leaky valves and have what are called varicose veins. But for the most part, they have these valves and they have they work with pressure within the body in order to keep blood flowing back towards the heart. So other aspects of veins, their walls are thinner than arteries so that they can expand and hold more blood. As your textbook states, at any point in time, they store 70% of the blood. If blood is lost, that is a hemorrhage. The nervous system causes the veins to constrict to increase the blood volume and thereby increasing pressure so you don't crash or you don't have go into shock because you have this drastic drop in blood pressure. So now let's talk about the heart. So the heart is located in between the lungs behind your sternum. It ports down towards the left hip. So you have the hip. I don't know why I can't get my words out nicely today. So it points down towards the left hip. And that tip of the heart is what we call the apex. The more muscular side of the heart is going to be on the left side of the heart. And that's why when you put your hand over your chest, you feel it beating more pronouncedly on your left side. And that's because it's more muscular. Chamber of the heart is on the left side. It consists mostly of cardiac muscle, which is we call myocardiac, are made of cardiac muscle cells, which we talked about in chapter 13. Muscle fibers are branched, connected by those intercardiolytic discs that we already talked about. We also have a type of cell junction there called desmosomes that prevent the overstretching of the heart because we have these four chambers in there that will fill with blood and expand. So it keeps that overstretching of those muscle cells from taking place and it keeps them all together. So we consider your heart a double pump, and that means that the right side of the heart is going to pump to a certain area and the left side of the heart is going to pump to another area. So the right side of the heart pumps to the lungs and only the lungs, and the left side of the heart, the more muscular ventricle down there. The ventricles are the two chambers on the bottom. The atria are the two chambers on the top. So the left side of the heart pumps throughout the body, and we say that's systemic. So here's just a really cool picture of some cardiac muscle cells and those gap junctions, which we have already seen and talked about in previous chapters. So your heart lives in its own little protective sac called the pericardium. It actually produces its own pericardial fluid for lubrication. So when your heart beats from top down, there isn't any friction that's created. If there were to be friction that was created between the pericardium and the heart, it could lead to inflammation of the pericardium and be kind of problematic. So that's why we need that pericardial fluid there to reduce that friction and make sure that the area stays lubricated. So if we were to take your heart and we would open it up, we would see that you have a septum or a divider that divides that double pump between the left side and the right side of the heart. So there are four chambers, two at the top and two at the bottom. The two at the top are called the atrium. The two at the bottom are called the ventricles. And we have an atria and a ventricle on the left side and an atria and a ventricle on the right side. And remember, the atria and the ventricle on the left side, they pump blood all throughout the body. and the atria and the ventricle on the right side just send blood to the lungs. The atria are always going to receive blood, and the ventricles are always going to pump it to where it needs to go. So here is a very cool picture of a heart we have here. So let's go ahead and zoom in on some of these structures. So at the top of the heart, we see the aorta, and then we have these three large blood vessels that leave the aorta. We have the subclavian, brachiocephalic, the common carotid, and we have the subclavian over here. We also have our superior vena cava, and if we go down a little bit, we see the inferior vena cava. Both the superior and inferior vena cava will come into the right atria. The right atria is on top of the right ventricle. So when blood comes in from the body, so a few things that I want you to notice here, and I'm going to back out just a little bit, is that every heart that you come into contact with as a pitcher is going to be color-coded. The blood vessels are color-coded. Arteries are, for the most part, red. Veins are, for the most part, blue. The reason for that is it relates to the type of blood that they're carrying. Arteries are going to carry oxygenated blood, which means that it's picked up oxygen from the lungs. And as a result of them picking up oxygen from the lungs, it has a nice bright color to it. So the hue of the blood is going to be a more brightly colored because it's carrying that oxygen there. As a result, the blood vessels are more brightly colored. Now, in your body, in human bodies, you don't have red blood vessels and blue blood vessels, but we color code them when we're looking at pictures of them for learning purposes to help us kind of differentiate one blood vessel for the next, especially in an introductory class such as this. So arteries carry blood away from the heart. Arteries are, for the most part, going to be red. Veins carry deoxygenated blood. So this is blood that's already dropped off its oxygen at the tissue, and it needs to make its way back to the heart so it can go to the lungs to pick up more oxygen. So because it's lost that oxygen, it doesn't really carry that same hue. The color of the blood is slightly different. So because the color of the blood is slightly different, it gives the appearance of veins being a darker, more purplish sort of color. So veins carry blood to the heart, and veins are, for the most part, blue. And in a second, you're going to see why I say for the most part. So we have this deoxygenated blood that's coming in through the superior and inferior vena cava that drops its way into the atrium. It's going to drop its way into the right atrium. It's then going to go down into the right ventricle. It's now going to be pumped to the lungs through the pulmonary trunk and the left and the right pulmonary, because it's carrying blood away from the heart. So notice this blood is now going to be leaving away from the heart. Because it's going away from the heart, and I'm just going to draw a little line here. So blood now going away from the heart to the lungs, that way and that way. These are now called arteries. So this is the exception to that rule. We said before that arteries were always red, or we said for the most part, arteries are red. Well, this is an instance where arteries are blue. They're blue because they are carrying deoxygenated blood that came from the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava into the atria, down to the ventricles to make their way towards the lungs. So at this point, this is an artery, although it's blue. So over here, we'd have the lungs. We pick up some oxygen from the lungs over there. So we pick up that oxygen. And now this blood needs to go to the pulmonary. What do you think these are? Arteries or veins? Veins. The pulmonary veins, because they're carrying blood back to the heart. So when they come into the pulmonary veins, and you recognize that there's a lot on this side too. So this is where this guy's going to come back in. That way too. So when it comes back in through the pulmonary veins, it comes into the left atria, down to the left ventricle, and then up through the aorta and all throughout the body. So that's what we mean by that double pump. So there are two different types of valves that kind of are boundaries between the atria, the ventricles, the pulmonary trunk, and the aorta. We have the semilunar valves, and we have atrioventricular valves. The AV valves are reinforced by the chordae tendineae, so they kind of are held in place. And they're called the bicuspid or the mitral valve. So on the left side, it's a bicuspid or mitral valve. On the right side, it's a tricuspid valve. And then you have what are called the semilunar valves, which are at the base of the aorta and the base of the pulmonary trunk. So those are the two different types of valves you have, and you have four total: bicuspid or mitral, tricuspid, pulmonary, semilunar valve, and aortic semilunar valve. So here we have a heart that has been cut open for us. Yay! So let's take our colors back out again. And we have blood that comes in through the superior and inferior vena cava that makes its way down into this atria. It will then go through this tricuspid valve, which is this white thing right here. It goes through the tricuspid valve and will make its way up through the pulmonary semilunar valve and then on its way out to the left and the right pulmonary arteries to the lungs to pick up oxygen. After it's picked up that oxygen, it picks up oxygen in the lungs. That's the job of red blood cells. Then that blood goes into the left and the right pulmonary veins, into the left atria, through the bicuspid or mitral valve, into the left ventricle, and then on its way up, and I can't go back behind, through the aorta. So some other things that I want you to sort of be mindful of are the fact that we have these chordae tendineae, or the heartstrings, that help to reinforce the tricuspid valve and the bicuspid valve. And also notice that the left ventricle is much more muscular than the right. And the reason that it needs to be much more muscular than the right is because it has to pump blood, the left side of the heart, all throughout the body. So it needs to be much more muscular and have a much more forceful contraction. So we have a really thick septum wall here and a really thick septum wall there. And then this septum wall, not so thick. And the reason for that is because, well, it only needs to pump blood to the lungs. So now that we've talked about how blood flows throughout the body and the blood flows through the lungs, remember that the heart also needs its own blood supply. And as a result, we have coronary arteries, which supply blood to the heart, and they first branch off of the aorta, and coronary veins, which drain it. And they're going to always, this coronary veins empties into what's called the coronary sinus and empties into the right atrium. Now, coronary disease happens when you have a blockage in one of those coronary arteries, which can cause a myocardial infarction or a heart attack. So once again, forgive me on what this looks like, because this shouldn't be looking like this. This new Blackboard Collaborate, it's not doing what I wanted to do. But when we go a blood flow through the heart, we've already talked about this, so it will all be familiar. So blood comes through the superior and inferior vena cava, and it carries deoxygenated blood to the right atrium. That right atrium then goes through the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle. That right ventricle then goes up to the pulmonary semilunar valve, into the pulmonary trunk, to the pulmonary arteries, to the lungs in order to pick up oxygen and then make its way back into the pulmonary veins, which will drop into the left atria. So the pulmonary veins carry this oxygen-rich blood into the left atrium. It then goes down through the bicuspid valve, the left AV valve, into the left ventricle. The left ventricle pumps through the aortic valve, and then the aorta branches off into those smaller arteries, which leads to capillaries and venules, and then veins, and then back up to the vena cava to start that flow all over again. And so we talked about this as well, why the left side is thicker than the right side and what it has to do. Atria are always thinner than ventricles, the walls are, because the atria are the receiving chambers for the blood, and it's the ventricles that actually have to do the forceful contraction and the pumping. So how we control our heartbeat, or how heartbeat is controlled, is through what's called the cardiac cycle. So before we start to talk about the cycle itself, let's talk about how we measure this and what we are listening for and how we label these parts. So systole is the actual contraction of the heart. Diastole is going to be the relaxation of the heart. And so for most people, on average, it happens about 70 times per minute. If you're a super athletic person or you work out a lot, you have a lower resting heartbeat. So people that are athletic and have a resting heartbeat of like 40 to 50 beats per minute or something really ridiculous like that. And the reason for that is that they have a heart that's in really good shape. So they can pump fewer times and be more effective in the way that they're able to deliver blood throughout the body. So for a lot of people, average is about 70 beats per minute. Anything lower than that probably means that you're pretty athletic. So 60, 55, 50, those are for pretty athletic people. So there are two sounds that you can hear, which you're very familiar with, are the lub dub, and those coordinate to the sounds of the opening and closing of those valves. If you've ever been diagnosed with heart murmur, that means that the doctor or the physician or the practitioner can hear a swishing sound between the lub dub, lub dub. And that just means that the valves aren't completely closing on the relaxation and contraction. The proper valves aren't closing all the time. So we say that you have leaky valves. A lot of kids will have a heart murmur, but usually you grow out of it. If you have not grown out of your heart murmur, you've probably been told about this valve and what it is that you need to do or need not to do in order to address it. So here are the stages of the heart cycle that we talked about there, where we have, and this is an actual heart, those is aortic similar valve opening, and then that's what the bicuspid valve looks like. And when we have those valves open, then blood from the atria for both will go into the ventricles. When the ventricles contract or squeeze, that valve is going to close. Those AV valves will close between the atria and the ventricle. Those valves will close. And then the dub sound will open when the semilunar valves open up. So what controls the heartbeat for the conduction system is the SA node. So remember we talked about that we don't have to have constant innervation to the heart in order for it to do its job, nor do you have to consciously think about your heart contracting or beating in order to do its job. And the reason for that is because you have what's called a sinoatrial node that's in your right atria. That's your pacemaker. So that initiates the electrical signal to cause the atria to contract. So the atria contract, and then that signal from the SA node, which is in the wall of your right ventricle, will then go down to the AV node, which is also in the right atrium, but it's kind of at the floor of the right atrium, sort of at the base of it. And then that sends that signal down to the atrioventricular bundles, and those are kind of found in the septum, and then around to the Purkinje fibers, which wrap around to both the left and the right ventricles. So we have this sort of contraction that happens, which is top down. So although your heart is a double pump that is left side and right side, the way that it beats is top down. So atria contract first at that because of the SA node, and then that electrical signal is sent down to the ventricle so that they can contract next. And the way that that signal is coordinated is through these gap junctions and the intercalated disc that are found in the intercalated disc. So here's a really cool picture of that. So we have that SA node in the wall of the right atrium. Down at the base of the right atrium, we have the AV node that will then send this electrical signal down to the bundle branches of the through the septum. And then the Purkinje fibers go up through the left and the right side of the ventricles to cause that contraction to continue to move forward. So external control of heartbeat, so that's the internal control of it. External control of the heartbeat is coordinated by the control center of the brain, which is in your hypothalamus, really important part of your brain that we will talk about in the nerve. So it increases or decreases the heart rate depending on what it is that the body needs. There are also hormones that can increase or decrease the heart rate. Norepinephrine and epinephrine are two of such hormones that can increase the heart rate. If there's pressure, then the body can increase and decrease the heart rate. So those are all considered external controls of heart rate. So in order to kind of check out what your heart is doing and if it should be doing what we want it to do, we have ways to record the heartbeat. So we obviously can listen to it. We can do a pulse reading and listen to it and see what the beats are per minute. But we can also get a picture of the electrical activity in the heart. And that gives us a picture of how well the atria and the ventricles are contracting or how they're not contracting through what's called an electrocardiogram. So that's just a recording of these electrical changes. The atria is going to make the very first wave, and then the most pronounced feature of an EKG is QRS complex, and that is going to represent the contraction of the ventricles, and then the relaxation of the ventricles is going to be the T wave. And here we have a lovely picture of that. So P waves denote the atria contracting, the QRS complex, because it is a complex process of the ventricles contracting, will be shown here. And then we have this T wave, which is the relaxation of the ventricles. So you're probably asking, well, Kelly, do the atria relax? I don't see their relaxation. Well, they do relax. It's just that the QRS complex is such a bigger electrical event that it masks the relaxation of the atria. So that's why we don't see atria relaxing like we see the ventricles relaxing. So if the electrocardiogram does not look like this stereotypical way where we can see, okay, atria contracted, all right, ventricles retracted, all right, ventricles relaxed, all right, we see a nice, good, clean EKG. If we have something that looks like this, where we just have these huge QRS complexes that are all over the place, that means that the ventricles are quivering, like they're having these really funky contractions, and it's not really coordinated well to give us this nice clean QRS complex, and we don't even see where they're able to relax. So the ventricles are just kind of doing, if you clap your hands together really quickly, that would be ventricular fibrillation. Now, I don't know if your heart's gonna be going that fast, but, and like kind of cup your hands, that's what I'm kind of talking about there for ventricular fibrillation, which means that the blood is not effectively being pumped through the heart, which can cause all sorts of other problems. So other abnormalities that we would see in an EKG, we can have atrial fibrillation as well, AFib, but what we just looked at before was ventricular fibrillation. And then in order to get the heart to go back to what it normally needs to do to kind of shock, if you will, that electrical signal into doing what it's supposed to, we have a defibrillator. So we can apply the strong electrical signal to reset the heart, and hopefully the SA node will start doing its thing again. So that's the whole job of a defibrillator. It's kind of like smacking the heart, like, hey, get a hold of yourself. You're quivering too much. So it tries to shock the heart back to what it normally should do. So I want to talk about some features of the cardiovascular system. We'll talk about blood pressure here. That is a pressure that the blood exerts on the walls of the blood vessels. Primarily when we measure blood pressure, we're measuring the blood pressure within the arteries. The aorta will always have the highest blood pressure because it's directly attached to the heart. And gradually that pressure decreases as you get further away from the heart, as you go from the aorta to the muscular arteries to the arterioles and down to the venules and the veins, that pressure is going to decrease. Your pulse is defined as a surge of blood through an artery causing it to stretch and recoil. And we usually measure that in the radial artery at your wrist, so you probably like take it there, or at your carotid artery in your neck when you take your two fingers and you measure there. A measurement of the heart rate averages about 60 to 80 beats per minute. And remember, that for most people, unless you have some sort of health condition, if you have a lower heart rate at like 50 or 60, more athletic people have that. So the contraction of the ventricles is what creates the pressure, as you could probably imagine. And we can measure the pressure in your body, and we take it in the brachial artery of the arm with blood pressure cuffs. So remember that systole is going to be the contraction, and diastolic pressure is going to be the relaxation. So the highest pressure is when the blood is ejected from the heart. That's the systolic pressure. So that is that top number when you look at blood pressure readings of 120 over 80. And the diastolic pressure is that lower pressure when the ventricles are relaxed. So it used to be that average blood pressure, or good blood pressure, I should say, good blood pressure was 120 over 80. Cardiologists are now kind of rethinking that, and there are some cardiologists that would say that a good blood pressure would be less than 120 over 80, and that when we start to get at 120 over 80, we're actually approaching hypertension, which means that the blood pressure is too high. So with hypertension, there are lots of things that could be happening with that. Hypertension can cause stroke in various parts of your eyes, body. You can have strokes in your eyes. You can have strokes in your brains. It could cause a heart attack, high blood pressure, all sorts of things that could be very problematic and possibly life-threatening. Hypotension is inevitably low blood pressure. And really, the only drawbacks of hypotension are that you're going to be more prone to fainting and being lightheaded. So here's just a kind of a table for blood pressure in adults. So remember, like I said, normal blood pressure below 120, below 80. Pre-hypertension is now considered 120 to 139. So if you're at 120 over 80, that's usually considered pre-hypertension. Crisis is 180, where you require immediate care. So as we already discussed, blood pressure decreases as it flows away from the heart. Blood flow is the slowest in the capillaries, which makes sense because we need to make sure we have an effective exchange of nutrients and gases and whatnot. And it's also slowed down by the precapillary sphincters. When we get to the veins, the pressure is really low. So it does not, the pressure that's generated from the heart doesn't really contribute to how the blood gets back up to the heart via the veins. So there are a couple of ways that the veins are able to get blood back to the heart and compensate for the reduction in pressure at the veins. One is skeletal muscle pump, and that means that the skeletal muscles, your actual muscles, that are in the outside of the veins, when they contract there, they can actually push that blood forward. The next thing is that the veins have valves. So when that blood is moved towards the heart, the valves close. When those muscles contract, the valves open. When they relax, the valves close. So that blood only moves in one way. You also have the respiratory pump. That respiratory pump is going to, there are pressure changes from inhaling and exhaling that are created in your body. So the pressure changes between your abdominal cavity and your thoracic cavity, which are separated by your diaphragm. So as a result of those pressure changes there that happen from breathing in and out, you're able to create a vacuum, if you will, that will also help pull blood back to the heart. And so here's just a picture of those veins and when the muscles are contracting, opening up the valves of those veins, and when they relax, those valves close, and it makes sure that the blood does not flow backwards. So here's just a nice overview of that cardiovascular system. And I'll just give you guys a moment to kind of look at that and see what things that you find there. All right, so those two circuits that we talked about, the right side of the heart going to the lungs and the left side of the heart that pump, I should say, going to the rest of the body. Well, we call that right side of the heart, that circuit that it goes to, the pulmonary circuit. So that's where we have the gases exchanged, because the pulmonary, right atria, right ventricle, pulmonary trunk, pulmonary arteries, lungs. That's where it's going to pick up that oxygen. And then the continuation of that is that after that oxygen is picked up, it makes its way to the pulmonary veins, which dump themselves into the left atria. When it gets dumped into the left atria, now we are at the start of the next circuit, which is going to be the systemic circuit. Systemic circuit is left atria, left ventricle, pumps blood all throughout the body. So the arteries branch into muscular arteries and then arterioles and then to capillaries. Those capillaries go to venules, which go to veins, which then go back to the right side of the heart for the pulmonary circuit. So those are those two circuits which coordinate with those double pumps, right side pulmonary circuit, left side systemic circuit for the heart. So blood pressure, so we talked about capillaries being the exchange vessels, and you probably may be wondering, and in case you weren't, I'm going to tell you anyway, exactly how does this exchange happen? We've just kind of very rudimentarily said, well, we're going to exchange gases and nutrients and waste products in the capillaries. So what happens there is that there are two forces that will drive fluid in and out of the capillaries. You have osmotic pressure and you have hydrostatic forces on here. So blood pressure drives fluid out of the capillaries, mainly at the arterial end of the capillary bed, because there's a lot of pressure there. And that fluid contains everything that the blood contains, except for cells and those big, like, plasma proteins, you know, globulin proteins. Osmotic pressure, so the hydrostatic pressure is another way for saying blood pressure, drives fluid out of the capillaries. So all those good nutrients, that oxygen gets dropped off, glucose, any of those good things, those nutrients get dropped off at that end. And then in order to pull the waste products and pull that fluid back into the capillary, then we have osmotic pressure that draws water and all of the stuff that's carried by the water into the capillary bed by osmosis, because at the venule end, there is a lower amount of water than we had at the arterial end or on the outside than on the inside. So water wants to come back in, and then it goes into the venule end. And that's why we have now have carbon dioxide come in, because there's a lower concentration of it. And gases diffuse as well, where they move from areas of high concentration to low. In the tissue, there was very little oxygen, so oxygen would be driven out at the arterial end. But there was lots of carbon dioxide on the outside of the blood vessels, on the outside of the capillaries, so they want to get inside where there is less carbon dioxide, and they'll be picked up by the red blood cells. And that's why we have deoxygenated blood that makes its way back up to the veins, into the venule end of it. So some tissue fluid, not all of it always gets captured by the capillaries. Some of it's going to enter lymphatic vessels, and at that point we call it lymph, which if needed, it can eventually be returned to the cardiovascular system. In fact, lymphatic vessels kind of branch out and they're connected to the venule end of the circulatory system. So some cardiovascular disorders that we'll talk about, and in general, cardiovascular diseases can be disorders of the blood vessels, or which primarily they are, and they can be disorders of the heart. For Western countries such as the United States and Western Europe, it is the leading cause of early death, and that's directly related to diet and lifestyle choices. So it does not have to be a chronic condition that you have to take pharmaceutical drugs for. Cardiovascular diseases can totally be prevented for the most part for some people that may have congenital, or they're born with certain things that happen in their body. But most of cardiovascular diseases, things like hypertension, atherosclerosis, they are directly related to diet and lifestyle choices and exercise. And arteriosclerosis and hypertension can lead to some really life-threatening conditions such as strokes, heart attacks, and even aneurysms. Aneurysms are where the blood vessel actually bursts or bulges because there's so much pressure that's generated on that blood vessel, and the wall of that blood vessel becomes very weak, so it kind of pulls out, and if it can even burst and cause internal bleeding. So hypertension is high blood pressure. We call it the silent killer because it has very few symptoms until it actually can cause a kidney to fail, a heart attack, or a stroke. Usually with hypertension, it can be treated with diuretics, which increase the production of urine. And as a result of increasing the production of urine, you're releasing some of the volume that happens in your blood. So the volume of the blood is reduced. So as a result of the volume of the blood being reduced, the pressure that's generated on the walls, the arteries, also becomes reduced. So we can treat it with diuretics or we can treat it with other drugs. Hypertension can also be treated and most effectively is treated. Now, if you're having very acute cases of hypertension, you probably need to be on some medication in order to help your body so that you don't have this really high life-threatening blood pressure. But along with taking that medication, changing your diet, reducing the amount of sodium that you have in your diet, because sodium pulls more water in, and that's going to increase the volume, which is going to increase the pressure. So reducing the amount of sodium that you have in your diet can also reduce blood pressure, and having a nice, good exercise schedule, even if it's just walking for 30 minutes a day, and making sure that you eat lots of leafy green things, and you have lots of proteins, and kind of maybe cut back on some of the carbohydrates. In Western society, we consume far more carbohydrates than we actually need. Arteriosclerosis is a buildup of arteriosclerotic plaque in the walls of the artery. So when they're talking about plaque, this is what we're talking about. This plaque narrows the blood vessel's diameter, which also will increase blood pressure, but will decrease blood supplies to the tissues that need it. It can also cause clots to form because of the roughened walls of the arteries. A thrombus is a clot that just stays in one place. An embolus is a clot that detaches and moves to a different site. And a thromboembolism is an embolism that becomes lodged in a blood vessel. If you have a pulmonary embolism, that means that we have a clot that's made its way to your lungs or any of the blood vessels of your lung, which can be fatal. So here's a picture of that, and we have fat that usually accumulates in the walls of these blood vessels that causes this plaque, and here's just an actual picture of plaque in a blood vessel taken with a microscope there, so we can see that in there. Now, in Western cultures, we have been prone to, and we've been programmed to understand what fat can do to the body if you don't have the right kinds of fats. And then we think about high blood pressure, we think about these plaques forming. But I want you to keep in mind that if there are fats that are, fats are very important for your body, first of all, and we have lots of fats that are really good for you. Grass-fed butter is a good fat for you, and as with all things in moderation, olive oils, any oils that can be pressed very easily and from where it's from, whatever plant that it's received from. Corn oil, not so much, because it takes a lot of processing to get the oil out of that corn. But olive oils and grass-fed butter are really good fats that have not been shown to cause plaques and arteries in the same way that other types of fats have been. And as I said, with all things in moderation. So a stroke, it occurs when a cranial artery is blocked or burst, but it doesn't always have to be a cranial artery. You can have a stroke in blood vessels in your eyes, and that can actually cause macular degeneration, or it can cause lead to blindness. If you have a stroke in your brain, that part of the brain will die because it's not getting enough oxygen there. Symptoms of a stroke include numbness of the hands or face, difficulty speaking, and the inability to see in one eye or another. Those can all be telltale signs of a stroke. Heart attack or myocardial infarction is where a part of the heart dies as a result of not getting enough oxygen there. And that's usually as a result of a blocked artery. Usually it starts with just chest pain, angina pectoris, and that can be from a partially blocked coronary artery there. We can treat it with drugs that will dilate the blood vessels. But remember, this can be prevented for most people with proper diet, exercise, and lifestyle changes. Aneurysm is a ballooning out of the blood vessels. If a major artery ruptures, it can cause traumatic internal bleeding and actually lead to death. Arteriosclerosis and hypertension weaken the blood vessels that cause them to develop, to balloon out. So how we can treat clogged arteries are, first, we can prevent them from happening. They say an ounce of prevention, I believe it's Benjamin Franklin that said this, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. So we can prevent them with what? Diet, exercise, lifestyle choices. But other ways that we can treat clogged arteries are a coronary bypass operation where we take a vein from the leg and we just put in the heart and just go around where the blockage is. Gene therapy, so we can inject genes for vascular endothelial growth factor that will induce the growth of new blood vessels, and that way we don't have to do bypass surgery. Angioplasty, where we insert a stent into the artery to kind of hold it open, and usually they'll coat the stents with some sort of drug to help dissolve the blockage as well. And so here's just a picture of how the stent would be used and inflated in there. And then we have these bypass that we can just go around different blockages. So heart failure is defined as the heart's inability to pump properly. Treatments, but remember, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, so we can prevent this from happening, but we can wrap the heart to prevent it from getting enlarged. Many times, now people that have an enlarged heart that are very athletic, they have a big heart because it's a muscle and they work that muscle a lot. some people that have a sedentary lifestyle, well, people that have a sedentary lifestyle that have an enlarged heart, their heart is bigger because it's trying to pump harder to compensate for its ineffectiveness at getting blood to your tissues. So it's pumping really hard, and not because you're doing athletic activities. It's pumping really hard because there are a lot of blockages that it has to try to get past. So as a result, it gets really big, and then it just doesn't pump effectively. So we can wrap the heart to prevent it from getting enlarged. We can implant an ICD that corrects an irregular rhythm. We can do heart transplants. We can inject stem cells. We can have a battery-powered pump to assist the heart, the left ventricular assist device. And we can do a total artificial heart, which is really a temporary solution. And this is kind of what that total artificial heart looks like. And it is that double pump that we have. Still have that double pump there. And you still have superior and inferior vena cava, and the aorta is there, but this is only meant to be a temporary solution. And the electrical signal doesn't come from that SA node, it has to come from battery packs. All right, so that is all of chapter 5 and chapter 6. We're going to talk about blood and all the fancy things that blood does. So have an absolutely fantastic morning, afternoon, or night, and until then, see you soon.